So we look at killer acquisitions, which are acquisitions of innovative targets, where after the target is acquired, the innovation project, in particular the drug project that is being carried out by the target, is terminated after the acquisition occurred. So it's a situation that's a little bit surprising, where you buy something in order to then shut it down. And we look at the reasons why this occurs. And our story is one that has to deal with the protection of market power.
Yes, our main analysis proceeds in two steps. The first one is that we write down a very formal model that we try to rationalize this phenomena. And as Florian just mentioned, the main driving force behind those killer acquisitions is that the incumbent firms try to protect their market power, and hence they want to kill potential future competitors through terminating their innovation projects. And in the second part of our analysis, we focus on the empirical analysis, and our setting is the pharmaceutical industry, where we focus on the drug development process. And what we find is that drug development projects are terminated more often after they are acquired, particularly when this acquired drug projects overlaps with the acquirer's existing pipeline development. And through this new setting of drug development, we basically show that this phenomenon is pervasive and could be very detrimental to the society.
There's 750 drug acquisitions every single year on average. And our best estimate for how many killer acquisitions occur is about in the range of 7%, so about 54, 55 killer acquisitions per year.
We are surprised by that, and we are also concerned by this number, because in our very simple back of the envelope calculation, if we actually could control this problem a little bit better, actually it would lead to a 5% expansion of, or more efficient use of, the R&D expenses of the pharmaceutical companies. To understand the magnitude, we could also compare the effect of the killer acquisitions, as well as some other things that was trying to correct the inefficiency in drug development. And we do feel like this is a phenomenon that has been somewhat overlooked by both regulators as well as the industry practitioners. And we think this should be something that people should keep in mind when they go forward in the regulation process.
As researchers, we always have to be very careful in interpreting these results and extrapolating from our sample to the wider economy. Now, we want to be particularly careful about is saying this: it's true that these killer acquisitions seem to reduce the level of innovation ex post, namely that the acquisitions that occur that then lead to shutdown of innovation at a greater rate than what would happen if those targets stayed independent. But that may also have a positive ex-ante effect. So, you know, if I'm an entrepreneur and I know I'm going to get bought out in a killer acquisition, then that may motivate me more maybe to come up with an innovation in the first place. So this is a classic economist answer where there's a trade-off here. And our paper doesn't speak to particularly that full trade-off, but really only speaks to the ex-post inefficiency that we highlight when we talk about these killer acquisitions.
I think there are two ways to think about this. The first one is from the innovation domain, and the second is from the patient's welfare in general sense. One of the motivating examples that we have in our paper and partially motivated our analysis into the problem is a drug development company called Mallinckrodt. And this company acquired a drug development project in particular that overlaps with one of their existing drug projects, and they acquired this project and the shelf of the whole project and never developed it. In general, we do feel like from the perspective of treating more patients and creating more opportunities for patients to be treated by more and more useful drugs, I think this is particularly important.